Y'all ready? Howdy, howdy, howdy. I can't miss my howdy, 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 right? And welcome. And most everyone wants, we want the hope. We want hope. And we feed off hope. It's like the hope for, you know, making it to work safely, or the hope that our job promotes us or whatever. We all like hope. We live in the hope of winning the lottery or moving up in our job or being discovered by Duck Dynasty for season 55 and becoming rich and famous, right? So, but the truth is, most never will achieve anything other than the same old, same old. And it's not because they can't. Because it's about change, and you've heard it probably a million times, right? You do the same thing over and over, expecting different results, and that is the definition of insanity. So it's just the way it is, and the sad facts are most do the same thing over and over and over, and nothing changes. I have a daughter that works a regular job, and she likes her job, but she's getting sick of her job, but she always liked it originally. And then, you know, she hopes for something to happen, like something magically is going to happen. And it won't until she decides, hey, I got to make a change. I got to change something. It's not like her boss is going to walk in and go promote her to president of the company. So it just doesn't happen like that. It's scary to make big changes, because change involves risk, and especially the risk of failure is our biggest fear. And I know I've been scared to death before of taking risks and the risk involved, but often it's in those moments, whether by choice or by force, like in my situation, it was by force. You know, the change to hot dog vendor from multimillionaire furniture dealer was not by choice. It was circumstance. So sometimes we're forced into change, and other times we have the opportunities and we pass them up. We see, though, in these changes, the biggest and greatest results in our life. It's like J.K. Rowling. I'm sure you know, have heard of her. I've never read Harry Potter series, but my kids did. And she was literally destitute and still pushing her writings. Her claim to fame is not only all the cool stuff she does for humanity, but she is the first billionaire author just strictly off her book. First one ever, male or female. So pretty cool. It means that you don't have to start with money, you know, to get money. And coming from bankrupt food stamps, I know the way to success. Now, I'm obviously biased, because this provided me not just success, it provided me freedom. And you're going to hear from some other vendors tonight that will share some of that when they introduce themselves. But when so then you have the real life versions of, I don't know if you've ever heard this before, but you have in real life the versions of the frog story. I love this story. It's where three frogs fall into a well. And they're jumping like mad to get out, and all their frog family shows up, and they're looking down the well going, oh my gosh. And they're screaming at them, just give up. It's futile to try to get out of that well. Just go ahead and take the leap to the bottom and put yourself out of your misery. You're not going to make it. Well, two of them took that advice, while the third frog just keeps jumping and jumping and jumping and jumping, and finally makes it out of the well. And when he makes it out of the well, they're like, oh my gosh, why? You didn't even listen to us. That's awesome. You didn't listen to us. And he's a lip reading frog, because that frog was deaf. And so when he looked up and saw everybody screaming, and he thought it was like a cheerleading, you know, they were cheering him on. Come on, come on up, come on up. And so he just never gave up, because he was a deaf frog. And I like that story, and I probably butchered it up, but I heard it years and years and years ago. And so then you see what your perception of a reality can change. That deaf frog saw what was a negative as a positive and changed his life. We are even fighting past battles within, okay? There's battles within us. not only the battles from people saying you can't do it, you're going to do what? Hot dogs? Are you a moron? I promise you, if you ask some of the participants tonight, some of our panelists, the pro vendors, you ask them if they had anybody in their family give them sideways looks when they said, hey, we're going to open totally fried food truck. It's going to be awesome. Just see. And they go, what? What are you talking about? You're opening a hot dog cart. You're opening a snow cone. You're opening shaved ice. You're opening lemonade. Are you nuts? Lemonade's for kids. That's the most one I get. People email me and go, Ben, that my wife is saying lemonade's for kids. Ain't nobody going to buy this. And what's funny is if they could get in my head or get into my email and just look at all the proof, they would never question that again. So anyway, we fight some of these external battles with people either looking out for us or just being negative. And then we fight internal battles because we are conditioned by our past. Okay. Our past oftentimes condition us to be, whether we are go-getters or we give up quick or whatever. And sometimes it's hard to break those ties that bind. And it reminds me of another story that I shared this a while back in Vendors United, but a man was visiting Africa and he came upon loggers using elephants to move logs. And he noticed each elephant had a tiny, like a little, you know, twine rope tied to one leg and the other end held by a human boss, so to speak. He watched as these massive animals picked up huge logs and tossed them into piles without even, you know, a sigh. It was just easy for him, thinking surely they could free themselves at any time from their boss or even snap this little rope at any whim. They didn't. So he asked one of the handlers, how do these tiny ropes hold such massive animals? And this is true. This is a factual thing. They use little tiny ropes to hold these massive elephants. And they go, well, the handler said, well, when they were born, we attach a rope to begin training. And while they are weaker and much smaller, the rope keeps them from escaping and staying in line. However, when they get older, they are so conditioned to thinking that rope is unbreakable, they never attempt to break it, which they could easily if they only knew, right? But they just think, oh, these ties that bind, I can't escape my past, or I can't escape my three divorces, or I can't escape working here and trying to do this too, or I can't escape child support and I just never going to get ahead, or I can't get out of the seat of this big rig and stay home more with my family and I'm going to end up losing my wife and kids, or whatever it is, there's ties that bind. And you maybe think, you know, you try to convince yourself, oh, I'll stay in this truck because I'm being a good provider and I'm being a, you know, but sometimes you need to go, you need to look at those ties and go, do I really have those strings around me? And can I break those strings? Well, absolutely. Yes, you can. So what's holding you back? What's holding you back in life from getting what you want? The little bitty threads of nothing that are preventing you from breaking free and living your life to the fullest. And your struggles and obstacles aren't strings and ropes, but are motivation to break free. They are why you're even listening to me now. Your struggles in the past are the power of your future. Okay. So that man that found the cocoon, and this is another old story, but I love it. He found a cocoon and he's like, man, this is awesome. And he goes, I'm going to watch as this caterpillar metamorphosizes, if that's a word. He morphs into a butterfly and he's going to watch it. So he takes that twig off that limb and, you know, and takes it inside and he sees the movement. And for hours and hours, this thing that's inside, this future butterfly, is working his butt off. I'm talking working his butt off trying to get out. Well, all of a sudden, the work quits. It just stops. And the guy's thinking, oh man, he's just worn himself out. This butterfly is never going to get out of here. So, and you may have done this yourself before. You cut the butterfly, you cut him a little bigger hole, because if you notice on a cocoon, right at the tip is an easy part for them to chew through and open, but it's narrow and it's hard for them to get out of that narrow hole. So it takes a lot of effort. Well, the butterfly came right out after he clipped it, but it never could fly. It never could fly. It could only walk around, crawl around, whatever butterflies do on their feet. That's all it could do. And later he found out that that little hole that that butterfly was going to have to work through to get out actually squeezes against their fat little bodies and pushes, forces the fluids in their body into those little veins inside their wings. And it's what allows those wings to expand as they emerge from their cocoon. And he prevented that. And I don't know if he, you know, had to go to church three times on Wednesday to get forgiven, but the point of the story is sometimes we think we need help when sometimes the benefit is in the struggle. Okay. And when you're in it, it's hard to see it as that. It's like, I hate that, you know, oh, there's silver lining and everything. No, there's not. That's BS. I don't believe that. It's crap. To me, that's crap. Okay. Can you try to, you know, manipulate something to make something better? Sure, you could, but you're just trying to convince you. You're fooling yourself. And so, but sometimes struggles have a beneficial result. Like when you lose everything or you need to change your life for whatever reason, because you need more time at home or you need to spend more time with mom and dad because they're getting old and whatever it is. And so you may have to face a struggle. You may have to quit that job that keeps you away from your family. And now you struggle to get to a point where you can afford to provide and make things work. And that's why we're here tonight. So no one can do it here for you. No one can just make all this happen. We don't have a magic button. I was going to put one up on the screen, a magic button that you could press and we send you a check each week. Somebody works for you. That would be cool, I guess. But that's not how it works. So you can't avoid life's, you know, all of life's pitfalls and learning curves, but you can do stuff like you're doing tonight. You're investing time into learning something so that you are more capable of avoiding pitfalls that are common and obstacles so that you can get to from where you are now to where you want to be the fastest and with the least amount of harm, okay, or the least amount of struggle. So y'all, some of you have heard me talk about digging a hole, okay? Even if you've never seen one dug, you know, let's say you from somewhere out in the boonies, you've never seen a hole dug ever in your life and or ever seen a shovel. And we said, dig a hole. And we showed you, you know, we just told you or drew a picture of what a hole looks like. And you could probably dig a hole. You could probably use the wrong end of the shovel and still get a hole eventually, but it's not the most convenient. There's crap that you're going to have to endure that others that knew the information wouldn't have to, right? So you're going to have a few more pitfalls or obstacles. But if I came along or Keith came along and said, hey, I can show you how to dig that hole. And all you do is put the shovel in the dirt and then you scoop out dirt. And now you have a hole. And if you do those steps exactly that way, you get a hole every time. And that's how this business is. And no matter if you're going to go into lemonade or you're going to go street food vending, or no matter what your plans are, if you follow some simple steps, you will be, not maybe, you will be successful. Okay. I feel like a preacher right now, like I need an amen or something. But the point is if you do the things the right way, you period will succeed. That's it. There's no maybes. It's like hole digging. You're going to get a hole. So, and that's why we're here tonight. We're going to show you how to dig a hole. Thank you, Mark.
Amen.
I love it. I should have had some gospel music playing in the background. I got so spun up. I hoarsed my own voice. Because it gets me excited. It gets me excited because if y'all could see everything that I get to see, because of what's happened with teaching other people, I get to hear from literally 50 to 100 of vendors a day, and sometimes more than that. Sometimes it's potential vendors or going to be future vendors, but either way, I get to talk to a lot of vendors. And then in Vendors United, which all of these fellas that are here tonight with me to help you, they're all in Vendors United, and they help each other. We all share stuff, and we all get better. And every Monday night we meet, and we talk about this and that, and we cover if somebody's having a problem, we come up with a solution. And usually the solution's already been found by someone previous. If you've ever heard that saying, standing on the shoulders of giants, I think it was Einstein, or maybe I think it was Einstein in relation to his stuff that he had come up with, because Einstein wasn't that long ago, you know, 50, 60 years ago. Einstein, well, 70, was around, right? He was in the 40s and 50s and doing all his magic. And then when somebody asked him, you know, you're awesome, you're like the smartest man to ever, you know, come on the planet. And he goes, no, I've been standing on the shoulders of giants. And what he was talking about is Newton and all the people that added to his knowledge. And I thought that was humble. You know, it was a humble point of view. And that's what we do. We stand on the shoulders of giants, because in amongst us right now, there are giants. There are giants in vending that help each other. And that's the cool thing. Y'all can open up your cameras at any point so everybody can see your pretty faces. That'd be cool. And let me start with Mark, because he's the first on my thing right here. So it's right in front of me. What I'd like to do is, if y'all know what an elevator pitch is, it's like a 90-second rendition of why you should buy this or buy that. I don't want you to sell anything. I just want you to tell a little bit about how you got started, who you are, what your company is, and whatever else you want to add. And it doesn't have to stay to 90 seconds, but let's move through them.
Hey, I can handle it.
Ben, you need to switch on the video. It won't let any of us switch the video on.
Are you kidding me?
No, he's not kidding you.
That is ridiculous.
Yes, it is ridiculous.
No, I want everybody to see how pretty I am.
Okay.
Yeah, that's coming. Y'all stand by. Prepare for that.
I'll get ready.
Yeah, I can't wait to see Michael.
There's that silver lining you were talking about, Ben. We don't get to see Michael.
Put your teeth in, Michael.
I'm doing this. Y'all should be getting some stuff real quick here.
No, Corey, you do that. There's no silver lining, and so the no silver lining is that we'll see Michael.
Okay, did it just work for somebody?
Oh, there's Mark.
Booyah.
And Mark, all right. Go ahead while I add everybody else.
All right, I'm Mark with the Great American Hot Dog Stand, and we're here in Central Alabama. I've been doing hot dogs for 11 or 12 years. We've been full-time for 4 years now. We primarily do street vending. We do events. We have some events we do, but primarily we're street vending and some special events. The years previous to the four, when we tried to go full-time 10 or 11 years ago, and our health department was mobile food hostile, and they did everything they could to make sure I did not, and I didn't have a group like Vendors United, and I got to a certain point where I spent $3,000-$4,000, and I finally just said, I'm going to get a real job. Went and got a real job. And 4 years ago, we went ahead and took the leap. We started out with a DIY cart. We built our own, and that worked fine for us. I got involved with Vendors United, discovered benscarts.com, ended up with a Cater Pro. Now we're running a Cater Pro, and we have a Stand King. You can find those at benscart.com. So that's the long and the short of that. And we're still in business, still paying the bills and having a great time. And I'm my own boss. If I don't want to go to work tomorrow, I just don't go. Although I'm going to go because, you know, like the power bill. So we're going to do that. But if I need to take off a day and go do something, I just take off the day. I don't have to ask anybody. I don't need to get anybody's permission. I don't have to fill out a form. I just take it off. We primarily do hot dogs and catering. Now we do a good bit of catering, but you know, hot dogs are our specialty. We do hot dogs, hamburgers. We do specialty dogs. We have a special dog every week or a special item. And we've done, you name it, we've done it off the cart. Everything from prime rib to a hot dog. And just about everything in between, except, well, there's a couple of things we haven't done, but we may do them before long. You never know. So that's the long and short of it here from the Great American Hot Dog Stand. You can find us on Facebook, facebook.com/ Great American Hot Dog Stand.
Love it. Another one you should be writing down to add to your list to watch. All right, Ken Packer, you're next on my list, Mr. Packer.
Yes, sir. Well, let's see. I started roughly around 2011. My name is Ken Packer. I live in eastern part of Tennessee. Unlike Mark, I have a full-time job, but I work, I sling in hot dogs and lemonade over the weekends. I started out in roughly around 2011 doing hot dogs, and after a first year doing that, I realized that I was going to have to get into something that provided sandwiches or something hot besides just the lemonade season because it was short. So I did some research, came across this hillbilly in Tennessee named Ben Wilson, and my life has never been the same since. I'll be honest with you. I listened to Ben for over a year every Sunday night when he used to have the Sunday night show every Sunday night. And I watched his videos on his YouTube channel, which is, what is it, Hot Dogs? Is that right, Ben? I think it's Hot Dogs on YouTube. You can find them there.
Ben's Carts on YouTube.
That's right, Ben's Carts, not Hot Dogs, Ben's Carts. Sorry about that, Ben.
No problem.
So I ended up building my own cart, just like Mark talked about. I got the kit from Ben. He had it on sale for a New Year's or a Christmas special, and I took advantage of that. Built my own cart and was slinging dogs whenever I could. Then about a year ago, I ended up winning a cash cow through VU. You know, and I do all kinds of things. Besides lemonade, I do hot dogs, hamburgers, Italian sausage, bratwurst. I do a variety of different sandwiches off the cart. I'm looking to do Philly steaks off the cart in the future. Barbecue. I'm going to get a smoker and then be able to serve the food right off the cart. But, you know, hanging around with Ben and these guys that's going to be coming up with Mark, Corey, Michael, Alex, and a bunch of them, you know, it's very important to learn from the pros. And I'm still learning from the pros. That's why I joined BU. In fact, I'm a lifetime member. I believe it's an investment for my business. Just a little plug for you to take advantage of BU. But if you want to seriously do this business, you know, hang around with professionals. And learn from them. Be a sponge. You know, I got a yellow pad and a pen right here for anything that might be come across to help me further my business tonight. And Ben's got his pad. So is Mark, a bunch of these guys. So that's pretty much it.
Well, thank you for that, Ken. I appreciate it. Corey, you're next on deck.
Hey, so Corey Lawrence, I run my wife and I, she's in the other room. She's the extrovert. I'm kind of the introvert, but she doesn't like get on the camera. So she's in the other room. But anyhow, the two of us run and operate O'Doggies here in central Missouri. We've been at it for since 2012. And kind of like Ken, you know, I've been listening to Ben and Jason and the gang on Sunday nights for a long time. At my previous job, I was a programmer. I'd have my headphones on. I'd be listening to the podcast while I was programming and doing stuff. And, you know, yellow pad. I was taking notes for probably close to a year. And I wasn't even sure I was going to do this then. And then just kind of things, one thing after another, and kind of forced into it, similar to some of these other guys. And Ben, you know, and them. And so lost our job, lost our division, shut down where I was working. And I built a hot dog cart. That following month, so in 2012, May 1st. So I built my hot dog cart, started selling hot dogs in June of that same year. And since had another home-built trailer for a while. Then we went brick and mortar. And we've been in the brick and mortar for about 5.5 years now. Still during that time, I bought 2 Cater Pros and a Stand King in the meantime. And so our son runs the brick and mortar for us, at least for now. And Susan and I, we just love the mobile side of things because that's where we started. But we love that part of it, getting out and going to different locations and just the people and everything. So Susan and I run the mobile side of things still, and still loving it. You know, it's like Mark said, if we don't want to work tomorrow, you know what, we just shut it down and say, hey, you know what, we're not going to be out tomorrow. We're fortunate enough right now, Susan and I are just out 3 days a week. So that's not to say we're not still working, but on Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, we take the Stand King out. And then on Mondays and Fridays, we kind of help get things going at the shop. But, you know, we can take a 4-day weekend if we really want to. And, you know, that's a luxury that I did not have before. I had a great job before, great employers and everything, but they weren't as good of an employer as I am. And so I'm much happier to be working for me. So that's the long and short of it there for us. You know, O'Doggy's 7+ years strong and still going. So
I love it. I love it. And it has provided for Corey a son that at any point in his life, because he's been around this, he could fall back on this at any point he wanted. It's a great, because there'd be no fear. There'd be no nothing. He's done it. It'd be like riding a bike again.
And he's better than I am at it. So,
all right. Mr. Michael Wood.
Hey guys. Besides being the oldest one here, I've actually been vending longer than anybody else. I started actually in 2009. I have an anniversary coming up, matter of fact. But I only do hot dogs and sausage dogs. I'm part-time. I've been part-time ever since I started. I'm going to remain part-time. And everybody makes a joke about that. And yes, I do catering and everything else. I am part-time. I'll be on the street tomorrow, Friday, and I've got a gig at my dealership on Saturday. So that just shows you how part-time I am. I only do hot dogs, sausage dogs. I have a big dog. I actually had, this is my second big dog. Give Ben a plug at hotdogcartstore.com. Anyway, you know, he's paying us to tell everybody that.
That's right. Yep. No, money's seriously. In the checks in the mail, Michael. Checks in the mail.
Checks in the mail. But if you hear good, you'll know who I am because – that's my logo, Doug's Dogs. The best advice I can give anybody that ever starts in this business is do your homework first, make a plan, and then understand that it is a business and it is work. So that's the best advice I could give. I actually enjoy it. I've been doing it for 10 years, so I must get something out of it. I don't know what it is. But normally, if Google is one of the best things that's ever came out. When I started out, I don't even think they had Google. You had to actually go to the health department and get a copy of the code. You know, that would be the best advice I'd give you is, you know, make a plan to work and work the plan. Anyway, good.
Awesome. Thank you, Michael. All right, Mr. Diz, if you're available, if you're not, I'll come back to you. I don't know if he's got a cart down there. I see his video. So let's jump over here to Mr. Keith.
Hi, everybody. My name's Keith Gilliland from Canton, Ohio, the Pro Football Hall of Fame. Sunny Beach Concessions is the name of our business. I didn't start out wanting to do hot dogs or lemonade or anything. I own a printing company. I started that when I was 19 with absolutely nothing and built it up. Don't have a college education. Work hard and just piece things together. And that's the same thing with this type of business. We actually started out in lemonade. I see some people asking questions. Can you start with $1,000? Absolutely. We just started with a canopy. some lemons and some ice and some cups and a smasher, and away we went, and we built our way up. And my fiance Mary would be up in the morning. She used to have to get up at 5:30 in the morning and drive about 45 minutes to work. And every morning I'd get up and hear this guy talking, and it kind of an annoying voice, you know, and I found out it was Ben Wilson. So I was like, who's this Ben Wilson guy? So I started watching it. And the next thing you know, we ordered the book. And I tell you that, Ben, that's well done. I wish you would put it on audio, because I can't read that well. But, you know, we would highlight that thing, go over it. And we were so prepared that when we finally built up our money from the canopy, just doing lemonade to our first little trailer, we were prepared. I mean, we were completely prepared. We signed up for Vendors United. I hate to even say this. I became friends with all these guys that's on the panel tonight, and they are the best of the best. And here we are now, three trailers in. You know, we do one called Totally Fried, that we do fried veggies and cookies and all kinds of crazy stuff that we do bigger events with. We also have a Stand King, which I actually have more fun doing that. Mary loves that one a lot better than the fry trailer. And we're doing a lot of cool stuff with that, from car shows to little football camps to pulling into factories to do lunches. So I also want to give a plug for Corey and I. Corey and I became partners in a company with an app called Order Grub. So maybe Ben can talk about that later on. But guys, it can be done. The only thing I can tell you is be prepared. Get that book. Sign up for Vendors United for a month or two. Just come in. It's the best $27 a month that you'll ever spend. I became a lifetime member. It's that worth it. All these guys that's on this panel here today, they are very good at what they do, and they're there every Monday night pretty much.
Thank you, Keith. I appreciate it. I had muted myself, so I thanked you twice. And it was only worth one, so.
Diz is back.
Anyway.
Diz is back.
Diz is back.
Diz, you available to come in and introduce yourself a little bit?
Yeah, you got it. How are we all doing tonight?
Doing fantastic.
Good, good, good. So my name's Diz from Diz's Dogs. Daryl's around back to you from Lansdale, Pennsylvania. We're about an hour north of Philadelphia. You may see some of the stuff out there that I may have posted on some other websites or even Facebook pages. But we basically started off with a hot dog cart, Ben's Big Dog Cart. Hold on one second. I got a young lady here looking for a hot dog. So I'm going to talk while I serve this young lady. Let me know what I can get you, dear. Right there on the menu, just to your right. So we started off with this big dog cart from Ben. Now, just as Ben said earlier, the cost of getting into business can be, very inexpensive. While we're trying to push, products and so forth, one of the things being like Ben's carts, I bought my cart used. Real quick, and then I'll come back, all right?
All right, no problem.
Sorry about
all right,
that.
I didn't think that we would get Mr. Alex Steele with Frankenstein's, which is now a whole nother name, because they're Primetime Eats, because they moved up in the world. I think he's got two carts now and a trailer, and he's making all kinds of changes, and it's fun to watch his progress. Because Alex has been all in from day one, and I want you to meet him. Alex, go ahead.
Hey, I'm Alex Still. We have the Still family that we all work together really well. So that picture he's got in the background right now was, I think there's a lemon smasher on that table. That's the cart we had and our umbrella set up. That was years ago. I still don't have that same vehicle. Primetime Eats and Catering is going to be the new name. Started from Frankenstein's. I did the entire system, Janessa, 3 years ago at Christmas time was on the internet and found Ben Wilson. I didn't know him. We in Florida tried to start this business. we found him. I got that book. She got me the book for Christmas, and we read that book. And I put into practice everything he had verbatim. And it was a tough struggle. I have a food and beverage background. I've worked and managed and done everything you can in food and beverage. The startup cost, like they said, is low. Good entry point. I worked really hard, had some struggles to start with, and worked through them. And what really helped me was staying with this group, because there's a lot of support that you can lean on that can help you through things and new jobs. I started just on the street. Like, that's us at O'Reilly's. We don't really do the street anymore. And like he said, you wouldn't. And it's hard for me to find time for the street, because I'm looking at the weekends where before I said 1500 to get into an event, you know, was way high, or 500. Now we're paying that. We're getting big returns. We're doing lots of catering. We have two hot dog carts and a stand king. We still do the hot dogs, the brats, the sausages, but we added brisket. Brisket's going to be a big deal for us, and hamburgers. The spectrum, if you would have told me 3 years ago where I'd be right now, I wouldn't believe you. And there's been ups and there's been downs, but it's people that have your back that can just, you know, stand there with you and be like, look, I've done this. You can do this. We can all do this together. And I appreciate everybody that's in this group and even being able to come on here and tell you guys my story. You know, I've even helped a few vendors in this area come up and go through the ranks and still kind of work for me. It's been just, so today we went to the river. We just had the chance to go to the river. My kid just got into kindergarten. I've had time with my family that my entire schedule does not revolve around, you know, nighttimes and weekends, which food and beverage makes you do. We do what we want, and it's insane. I'm about to say no to the North Carolina State Fair, the Mountain State Fair, because it's not what I'm set up to do now. And I've been through a bunch of things, and you have to realize sometimes, you know, you shouldn't be in this avenue when you need to get back over here. And I just, the elk festival that's going to be in Mag Valley, and I have a bunch of elk and venison to sell too. So, you know, life's really good. You know, we were Frankensteins. We are now Primetime Eats and Catering. You'll see Janessa. I'm Alex. You'll see Avery running around the those. If you have any questions, you can hit me up on Messenger. You know, I love to help people. I really do. If it's, you know, a good question I can help with, but that's me, and nice to meet you.
Well, thank you, Alex. All right. Back, so Ben. Do what?
I said, I'm back, Ben.
Have at it, brother. Thank you.
All right, sorry about that, but you know, hey, number one, customers are the most important thing, so I had to take care of that there, lady on the side. So, again, my name is Daryl Zaremba, Diz, otherwise known as Diz. I live in Lansdale, Pennsylvania, again, about an hour north of Philadelphia. This is our logo right here. So my story, I started off about 3 years ago, but I bought the cart 5 years before I started the business. And just as Ben said earlier, you've got family members and friends that kind of say, what, are you crazy? Well, my young Jewish wife from Brooklyn looked at me like I lost my marbles when I bought this cart. And I bought my cart used. And it's a Ben Big Dog cart, but because of the cost and the money we had at the time, it's the only thing I could afford. And to this day, it still holds up well. So, you know, if you can't afford to buy new, you buy used, you know, hopefully a good quality one. But in any case, again, I sat on this cart for about 4 years, 5 years. It sat in my woodshed. It sat out by the back of the garage under a tarp. The short of it is, about 3 years ago, we're out to dinner with friends, and they convinced us, just start the damn business, Diz. And that's what we did. But all we had was basically this cart and a 4-foot table next to us, and that's the way we did our first gig. We did a very simple menu, and we continued that for a couple of weeks, a couple of months, and we let the business grow itself. So as we had extra money, we bought some extra things. So, you know, for instance, we got away from doing the chips in the box, and we bought this chip rack. Right? This chip rack we bought 3 years ago, it's paid for itself, you know, a couple hundred times, but it allowed us to be a little more professional. We bought some tablecloths. Again, we didn't start out like that. We didn't invest all our money right off the bat and say we have to buy all these expensive things. We do what we could with what we had, and we became very successful at it locally. So to this day, now we've gone from that cart, and now we're using a trailer and a cart. So, you know, we just bought this trailer about 3 months ago, And eventually we're going to retrofit it out to have a full kitchen inside of it. Just like a big dog, just like a Stand King. Again, for us financially, we just couldn't get into a Stand King. We wanted to. That's a very, very good quality product. You'll probably end up seeing my trailer kind of close to the build on that. Ben, trust me, I'm not taking any of your patents. But because I know his layout is successful, why recreate the wheel? So I'll probably take some tips from that and kind of move forward. Our menu is very simple. That menu there is nothing more than hot dogs, kielbasa, burgers, cotton candy. We also do popcorn, soft pretzels, chips, candy, soda, water, and we do fresh squeezed lemonade at some events. And that's all our menu is. That is it. We are that simple. People love it for that simplicity. Because again, sometimes it's just about simplicity, getting customers in and out. We are not a quote unquote street vendor, unlike many of the other ones you just heard from, because our situation is I'm a full-time teacher. My wife's a full-time school bus driver. God forbid I was to ever lose that job. I could go ahead on the street, to vend just as the other ones have been very successful at. But for us, events are very successful. So we do a lot of fairs, festivals, events, parties, a lot of catering. We just did a car show, a truck show this weekend. So we kind of mix that up with all different events. Tonight we're at a local concert in the park. We do a lot of them during the weekdays, during the evenings and stuff. So that's pretty much our story, short and sweet. Any questions, don't hesitate to give us a shout. I'm on Facebook. It's under Diz's Dogs, DizsDogs, right? The Facebook, there's our Facebook logo right there. You can also look us up on our website. It's www.dizsdogs.com. And my email address is dizsdogs@gmail.com. And that's DizsDogs@gmail.com. So, again, Diz from Diz's Dogs. Pleasure speaking to you all. Thanks for this opportunity to help train one another, and hopefully we can talk to somebody in the future.
That is awesome. Thank you, Diz. Watch his email blow up. He'll be regretting saying that. He'll go, Ben, can you mute out that section or beep it out for the YouTube?
Guys, don't send Diz any business questions on his business Facebook page.
Yeah,
that never. No bueno. No bueno. And as we say up here in the South, no good. Don't do that. Yep. Send him a PM, send him a private message, or send him an email, but don't put those questions on his business page.
Yeah, don't go, how much you profit you making on them cheese dip things? And none of that. So anyway, just be respectful and use common sense when you're caught reaching out to people. It's awesome that so many people help. We used to have a lady named Jackie that was helping vendors, and she got bombarded, and she called me up and she goes, Ben, take me off the list. I do not want to be there, because it was just maddening. So be respectful when you ask. Check learnhotdogs.com first or the YouTube and do a search. But let's get started with some of the stuff that everybody who's starting needs to know. Okay. These are things you must know that will be good advice that a lot of us wish we'd have known, or that were smarter than me and did it the right way in the beginning. One of the first things that I noticed, and y'all can jump in anytime you want. But one of the first things I noticed with any new vendor, or most new vendors, we get it. We already have that entrepreneur spirit. We're ready to go. We're like, yeah, I'm going to do hot dogs. And you wake up the next morning and you've had 17 dreams about all the things you're going to do. And by noon the next day, you've got 47 menu items, 85 different types of mustard. You have just turned into your worldwide headquarters are right there in your trailer park. And that's how I was. It was like, everything just came, and what you've got to do is gear it back, tone it back, and you know, drop back and punt and go, you know what? I'm going to do it the way they said to dig the hole. I'm not going to use dynamite the first time, and I'm going to find out where to dig. So for the best results, because if you start off right, we've all watched vendors in VU get in over their heads. And you know, go from a cart that cost them $3,000 to financing a $200,000 food truck and thinking, oh man, I can't wait to get started, but they ain't started yet. you know, and those payments, they start pretty quick. 30 days flies when you owe $200,000 on a food truck. So those are some of the things you're going to want to remember is write them down. Write them, go, I want to do this later. I want to do this. What I would tell you in the beginning is do your due diligence. If you're wondering what that is, it's free on the website at Learn Hot Dogs. Go find that information. It's all listed at the top of the page. Go through it. Be careful and do your due diligence and start minimal as possible. Don't go out and buy a big dog cart, okay? Go find a used cart or build one. Don't start as minimal as possible because it is a great feeling when you're 2 weeks in and you go, yeah, this cart already paid for itself. I gave $900 or $1,900 for it or whatever it was, and it's already paid for itself. And now I'm fixing to add lemonade with real cash. And instead of you'll see this like with Alex is a good example. Corey's another good example. Keith is a tightwad, so he wouldn't do these stupid things anyway. But Alex was careful. He started with a used cart. Alex could go buy a brand new Stand King right now. And instead, he searched the webs. And just before he got his Stand King, he found a big dog cart for sale, really dirt cheap, or some other cart. He found a cart, dirt cheap. He bought it. Then he finds this Stand King that was used and got it. That's the smart way. The smart way.
Well, go ahead, Alex.
Go ahead.
The whole business. I mean, and being able to get the whole business with gigs, because I never thought I'd be in Hendersonville, which is a big town south of Asheville. But it came with a four-day festival, came with multi-day festivals in a town that's hard to get to, and it came with all the tables, the chairs, the chafing dishes, the lemonade setups, the stands, the just every little thing you could think of, because I wanted to get into catering more. And then the whole thing came about, and it's silly. I've got the other cart. I got it for $900 from a ski resort. They had it sitting out, didn't know what to do with it. And I mean, I could sell it today for $15 if I wanted, but now it's time to just put people on it because I don't have time to be on the street anymore. I heard Ben say this for years. For 3 years, he would say, you're not going to have time to do the street stuff. And I was like, there's no way that's possible because that was my bread and butter. But now I have to find reliable people to do those because the planning and a year I had so much problems. The logistics of having yours come off flawlessly and be paid on time and be invited back next year. But it takes time to think all that stuff and have it all planned out and execute and then execute and just keep executing. And then you'll sit back, you know, years in and you're like, I can't do what I did years ago for that same price.
Exactly. So you've got a real opportunity, and it hurts me when I see vendors have the motivation, have the enthusiasm, have even the will and the work ethic to go do it, but then they overshoot it. You know, it's like when you run a marathon, you don't start with the 100-miler. You start doing small stuff like here to the sink or here to the fridge, and then you work your way up. So I want you to be mindful that it's easy to get caught into that and go the wrong way and then have a bad taste in your mouth because, vending doesn't work. $200,000 food truck didn't make a dime. Well, where'd you put it? Well, I didn't because I couldn't. And so do it the right way and watch other vendors. Just follow them and pay close attention to how they don't get in over their heads because this is a phenomenal opportunity to have freedom like you may have never known. Some of you may have known it, but you wouldn't be here if you didn't need any now. And so it's awesome to have freedom, unless you're Keith, you know, and you got 19 businesses. And I think he just does that as like, it's like masochism. He likes just inflicting himself with pain.
Hey, Ben.
Yeah, go ahead.
One thing, and you're right about some of that.
You know, the scariest part for us when we started, and probably all these guys that's been doing it for years, that the first inspection was probably the most nerve-wracking thing that we went through, because you think these people are these big, bad, nasty. But again, if you're prepared, like we were talking with all these guys, reading the book, that went easy. And once you get through that and then go do your first gig, it gets easier and it starts to get fun, because then you start getting into the marketing stuff and you start getting into more fancier dogs and you start saying, hey, I can fit in here or fit in there, or go do events like, you know, I do that. Alex is doing that, you know, and then get into the catering side. I mean, look at Michael. He would have never catered a few years ago. And he's making big money doing that. So it's not always easy. I mean, some of that stuff was frustrating, trying to figure out which do you go get first? Do you go get your business name first? Do you go get your license first? Do you have to, you know, there's four or five steps you got to do. And you guys made all that easy for us. Sometimes people get so frustrated, they don't even get started.
It is. It's easy to get overwhelmed, paralysis by analysis. And you can get in over your head. Okay, so let's do this. I'm going to throw out some questions. Y'all answer them. Y'all can just fight over who gets to answer it. I don't care. These are all from the group, the people that registered for this, and they submitted questions. I've got a little over 300 of these, so we're not going to make it through them all.
We're going to do 299 of them.
Yeah. You know what's amazing is, and I'll share this with y'all later in the group, many of these questions are similar to motivation. So when I started seeing those come in, that's why I did the opening the way I did it, because that is sometimes the only thing that's preventing you from having anything you want is the motivation to go do it.
True. So
I know that works well with me. I can listen to somebody, you know, a motivational speaker, or hear a friend tell me, hey, you got to do this. And I get motivated, and that's all I needed, that little nudge, that little push. Okay. The order in how to set up a business, the easiest, fastest, cheapest way. That goes on and on, but that was the gist of it.
Well, I might be able to give help there, Ben.
Yeah, go ahead.
I started with lemonade. I started with a plastic table you could buy at Sam's Club, for example, that folds in half. Started with a little electric juicer that actually spun, and you put the half a lemon on there, and it'll press down, it'll spin, and get all the juice and pulp out of it. And I had an umbrella, I had a banner, and a picket fence that I actually built. And I would put that in the back of a car. I didn't have a van, didn't have a truck. And I started out that way with, and I didn't even have a 10x10 tent. I just had an umbrella that I'd pop up. And it was, you know, I probably had about maybe close to $200 in it, I'd say. And it was that simple. And I started out doing like yard sales, baseball games. Then I started getting events, had to get involved with the health department, which the health department was real easy, because I started out with a simple menu, one item. I pretty much do that all the time, one item. I might have my hot dog cart out and do a couple items off of that, but I keep it real simple, and it's very profitable that way. Good example of why I do it that way is this weekend, just like last weekend, I'm going to Pennsylvania. I'm in the eastern part of Tennessee. I pop everything in the back of the truck. I rent a truck. I don't own a truck. I rent a truck. Last weekend, after everything was taken off the top, I ended up with about a week and a half. No, actually, no, I take it back. 2.5 weeks of pay that I would earn at work by just keeping it simple.
I love it. I love it. Thank you, Ken. Here's another one. I'm going to try to run through these quick, so y'all jump in. I don't care if y'all spend more time with them, because you're going to think of stuff that I wouldn't have thought of. This is about – there's two in one question here, which is no fair they cheated, because I said ask one thing. And but one was about his first event is enormous, and he thinks that's a good idea. What would you say to your first event being an enormous, huge event with your brand new hot dog cart?
I'd say, I hope you got a horseshoe up your rear end.
There you go.
So I've vended long enough. I feel confident I could take on about anything, and I would steer clear of a big event, period, anyway. The risk-reward ratio ain't good enough for me, and sure, I just steer clear. I watch people like Diz do small events, and I've watched Jason Brown do small events, small little gigs, small locations, and kick butt. That's my two cents. Anybody else?
Yeah, I'm 100% behind that, especially on your first gig. And we all, a lot of you, if you've been following for a while, there, a friend of ours, John Cavanaugh, his first gig was a pretty big, I mean, he picked up his cart on his way to the gig. I mean, that's kind of how it was for him. And, you know, if he was here to tell you now, he'd tell you that was a mistake, you know, but he did it. I mean, he persevered, but, you know, that's one of those things I would recommend starting low key.
Absolutely.
And the second part of this question is should he wait till the spring to start because it's about winter time?
Start today. Start tomorrow. Yep.
I don't know what state he's in, but there's all kinds of things going on all the way through October through in the cold states. You know, I'm in Ohio. We got stuff booked all the way till the end of October.
Yeah. October is one of my busiest months. And I'm booked out through September already, of course, but October is probably one of our busiest months. And we stay busy even in the wintertime too, but.
So, and you've got vendors in, we've got vendors in the group in Canada that vend year round. Is it more or less comfortable? Yeah. But they're a lot more selective with their gigs, and they're not just trying street locations willy nilly. They literally build it up and figure out where the best place for their time is.
And what else can you do, Ben, in the wintertime if you're in a cold state? Cater
out the butt. And that was another thing. Somebody said, I want to know as much as everybody knows about catering. It's down on my list a little bit, but I highlighted it because I have preached catering forever. And look at what Alex just told you he's doing now, these private gigs, Diz. Everybody's doing these to great success. If you're already vending, and I know we have some people in here that are already vending, you need to, you know what, I'm going to let somebody else answer this. I'm going to go ahead and I'm going to ask a question to the attendees. I've got a survey I think I prepared, maybe.
Get Michael Wood to talk about catering. I mean, he was always against that. Now he's yep. He's the cater guy.
All right. Y'all should see
Drop off catering. That's the one that's easy, quick, especially in the cold winter months. You can make it at your commissary, pop it in your coolers or whatever your transport means are, and drop it off at the corporation, set it up, and get paid. That's probably the best way to go. I ain't gonna tell you not to do a try to feed 1,200 people. I've done it, and you can feed 1,000 people in 1 hour if you have assistance from people from Alabama. That's a requirement. You got to call Alabama, you have to call Tennessee too, because Ben had to come help. But you can feed 1,000 people in 1 hour. We did it off of two carts.
Yep.
I have something too. We went to Moe's the other day. We were down to Hendersonville. Spending a lot of time down there now, but Moe's, I've never been there. Janessa said they had the best wings ever. They do have good wings. But if you take their cater menu, their to-go menu, and look at the way that I'm talking to people that aren't vending yet. If you look at their menu and look how they have it worded about drop off catering four different ways to cater. You know, you can pick it up, you can have it in ready to eat stuff, you can have us heat it up, you can do all this kind of stuff. And that's how you have to word your things, you know, with those catering gigs. Like, I can do this for you four different ways. I mean, first place, how much money do you want to spend? Like, let's get on the right foot right away, you know. And I got on BU the other day. I haven't been on the website in a minute. And I got on there, you know, doing this paperwork. Well, it's been 2 weeks. I got the cart. I have a cart permitted. I did all that. I meant to document a lot more of that. I'm sorry I didn't. But I have all the paperwork in the office still of where I got on BU, and everything I needed was right there. And I just made copies of the stuff I had. Boom, next thing you know, talk to the health inspector. Just want to see your water. It's hot. And half the time, they don't even know what they're doing. They really don't. So be over-prepared, but don't ask any questions and don't talk too much. Just let them do their thing and let it be over with. And next thing you know, you can go vending, you know. And it's a beautiful thing.
Excellent. Thank you, Alex. Okay, so I did a poll a minute ago, and we had 32% of you are already vending, 68% not vending yet. So for the 32%, and keep this in your back pocket for the other 68% that aren't vending yet, write this down. Ordergrubnow.com, write that down. And for you already vending, you need to go check that out, because this will change your business and offer other opportunities. And it's inexpensive for what you're going to get. And it will be a asset to your business that you will go, oh my gosh, I wish I'd have done this sooner. And it will bring you new business that you didn't know existed, all because it's magic, is the best way to put it. So check that out. And if you have any questions on it, reach out to Corey and Keith. They can give you more information, but you can go play with it. Not during the show, though. We're going to turn it off if you do. And then you'll go to bed early without a snack. Okay, so let's...
Hey, Ben.
Yeah, go ahead.
Can I throw something in here real quick?
Absolutely, bro.
I see 68% of you are not vending yet. Now, Ben talked about this at the top of the show, but let me say it a little bit differently. Some of that 68% out of that 49 people, some of y'all have not got started yet because you just haven't done it. Now, here's what I'm going to ask you to do. Change your mindset. Change the way that you are using your mind. You hadn't got started because you're scared. Now, do your due diligence and do all those things that we teach you to do at learnhotdogs.com, or pay the money and get in Vendors United. But once you do that due diligence, you have got to make a conscious decision to go do this. And then you've got to go do it. Put in the work to make it happen. Because here's what's going to happen. If you get into vending with this same mindset that, oh, I'm afraid to do that, or I don't know about making that, what that's going to lead to is you sitting up on a $92 spot and never moving. And then 6 weeks later, your stuff is for sale. And I'm going to buy it. Change the way you think in your mind. You need to be a street food warrior. You need to get out there, get after it, and get done. And when something ain't working, make a change. Don't you sit there and just stew in whatever it is. Decide in your mind that I am going to make a change, and I am going to make it work. That 68% of you guys, some of y'all are going to start vending. Get to it.
You know what, Mark, I love how you put that. It's almost, you know, it makes me feel good. It gives me chill bumps. Plus your voice is, it just does it. So my papa used to say, 6 months is going to go by either way. 3 months is going to go by either way. Where you are in 3 months is going to be determined by the decisions you make today. So, true. Change some stuff, make some changes. If you're trying to lose weight, then step back from the fridge every now and then, or run harder to get there. If you're trying to make more money and have more free time, you found it. Okay. Sure. There are other ways. I know of no other way that pays as much as it does per hour, rewards you so well, and is so easy to begin. Yes, there are some states harder than others. There is some red tape with everybody, but guess what? It's one time and done. One time and done. I know vendors that have a mile long of red tape to get started in some states, and they still do it. They persevere. They get over it knowing that I want to, they have a vision of where they want to be, and they'll have it. They know that they're going to come out tomorrow or 6 weeks from now or 2 days from now and have a freaking hole because they started digging. So that's what you got to do. Somebody wanted to know.
Ben?
Yeah, go ahead. Have at it.
Ben, I'm getting a lot of questions because I'm doing it on here also, but asking about insurance and credit cards. That's the two questions that I've got.
All right. Well, let's do this first. We're going to cover quickly commissaries because that was the second most asked question in the chat thing. Not the chat, but the pre questions to the registration. So commissaries, I'm going to give you the short and sweet, and then anybody can add anything. It can feel overwhelming. It can stop people in their tracks because they're like, what is a commissary? I don't speak German. And all it is a commercial kitchen. Okay. Basically, your unit is not self-contained, which means you can wash, rinse, sanitize, do everything from that cart. No, because you got water holding tanks. You got stuff you got to do. Now, some inspectors will say, hey, that's self-contained cart. You don't need a commissary. And more power to you. If you're in Knox County, Tennessee, I know the inspector and he'll tell you that. He'll go, you don't need a commissary. That big dog's got four sinks. You're good to go. And then you come over to my county, Sevier County, and the inspector's going to go by the rules in the state code and tell you, yeah, you still got to have a commissary. There ain't no way you can wash your pans in them little dinky sinks. And so that's how that works. So the bottom line is a commissary is easy to get. I've got tons of training on how to get it. It is a necessary evil, but once and done. Once and done. So get it and then make it a goal of yours. If you're having to share a commissary or you're having to rent one or you got one free but you just don't like it and can't use it as much as you'd like to, then make your first goal to build your own because they ain't hard to build. I've built them. Some of the other vendors have built them, and they make you money. They will make you money. So that's all I've got to say on commissaries unless somebody else, one of y'all have something.
Yeah, somebody's going to whine about not being able to find one. Well, boo freaking who. I went and, sir, I visited over 25 places to get my first commissary. You know why? Because I refused to say, I refused no. I wasn't going to have it. And so I had to visit a bunch of them. And but let me just tell you, I smoked about 12 packs of cigarettes in between each one because I was nervous and thinking, oh, this ain't going to work. But I kept on digging, baby. Just keep on digging. Find your stuff.
That's
well, great. Just get that paper off of learnhotdogs.com and think about it as all I need to do is get someone to sign this paper first so that I can get working. After that, it's between you and the health department to figure that out. As long as you can get somebody to say, yes, you can do this here. How much of it you do there, you know, I'm not a lawyer or I'm not someone telling you what to do, but to get working and get going, you know, one or two of us might have scrubbed a dish in the kitchen once before, you know, who knows?
Yeah.
But just get that paper signed and get rolling through the process. Don't let the government want some of everything. Just roll through it and, you know, don't ask questions.
That's great advice. And, you know, I talk about this in my book that a lot of people never see the commissary kitchen once they get one. But if you feel like you need to, or there's all kinds of workarounds. I have ways to get commissaries. Just type in the word commissary on the blog at Learn Hot Dogs. You will be just overwhelmed with the amount of information on how to get a free one and without much trouble. Now, Mark, having over 25 to get, it took him to get one. And then he realized that it was his teeth. He put his teeth in and then they gave him a commissary. So a lot of times
it's the high heels too, but you know,
right. A lot of times it's us that are our limiting factor. You know, if you go in there with your head down and, hey, I'm starting a hot dog business and I really need to use your kitchen. That'd be awesome. Could I use it? you're probably going to get a no. But if you go in there and go, hey, my name is Ben, my wife, Sabrina, and I, we just started this business with hot dogs. It's like a nostalgic cart, and we're going to be vending here and there, not that often. We don't know yet. You know, always downplay it, right? And go, the state requires us to have a commercial kitchen. Well, we can't even begin to afford one of those. But they said if we could have a restaurant that would allow us to clean our pans, you probably won't ever see us because we happen to have a sink at our house. But if you will allow us to list you as our commissary, it will allow us to get going. And you get to be the first customer for free or something. And it's just the presentation changes. Then it's not, you know, something bad. It feels okay. And you only do this once. You do it once and you're done. So anyway, Michael Wood, go ahead with your whole new change my plan and answer those questions.
Okay. One of the questions that I got was, where can I get insurance? I don't work for Flip Insurance, but you can go to Vendors United if you're a member of Vendors United and sign up on Vendors United for Flip Insurance. That's probably the best liability insurance out for the money. I actually have the trailer endorsement, so it costs me a little bit more each year. But I personally think I've had it for years. The other question was credit cards. Yes, if you're going to vend, it don't matter if you're doing catering or if you're doing street events or what you're doing, you do need to have credit card capabilities. For me, I went brain dead. Sorry about that. I've taken credit cards for years. You can do it with a cell phone. It doesn't cost you per month. And all you got to do is you can go to squareup.com and get Square. There's other companies out there. A lot of them, the Order Grub uses a different one. Snap is what it's called. But, you know, no matter what type credit card you use or company you use, try to get one that doesn't cost any money to operate. If you're paying a company money every month to have credit card capabilities, you're wasting your money. Square charges 2.75%. For a normal swipe.
Square is by far what Michael just told you about Square Up. Square is by far the best one. Okay. What he's talking about with Order Grub is Stripe, which handles it differently, but both of them, there's no fee to operate. There's not a monthly maintenance and stuff like that, unless you take, I think Square has some packages where you can, but the bottom line is it's a necessary evil in the business to take cards. You'll make a lot more money. So Square would be the way to go there. Anybody got anything to add about credit cards or, what was the other subject, Michael? I already forgot.
That wasn't fair. Credit cards and insurance.
All right.
That was the two questions, credit card and insurance. And you do need to have insurance because if you're going to do any kind of big corporation, events, or even on the street, it'll help you get locations because you can do a rider and which covers the business that you're in front of. If something happens to your cart, and you can show that piece of paper to them and say, "Hey, look, I'm fully insured. I've got a $2 million insurance policy." And people like that. That gives them another reason to have you on their location.
All right. We have some questions that came into the Q&A section. I don't know if y'all that are watching this, you have a Q&A, you have a question thing that will send us questions. One was, he's a Army vet, retired, just bought his first cart, used New York cart, wondering if military events were too big to start.
the biggest thing about doing any kind of event on a military installation is, number one, getting in. Number two is you have to be inspected by the veterinarian on the post. And there's different ways to get in. Normally, I don't know about every base, but I know our local base, the only time they allow vendors in is for the 4th of July fireworks. That's the only that's like open, you know, for anybody to want to go vend. But you can actually go to the military base and talk to them. And you know, I'm not saying you can't get in. I'm saying every base has different rules.
Keith, you have any questions?
Yeah, I see there's some people got their hands up, so I'm going to try to allow them to talk. So, Suzanne Zener, you're on. Ask your question.
I am so sorry I didn't unask my question. I was trying to figure out how to get the video off, the extra audio rather. Anyway, hello everyone, and hope everyone's having a good evening, and this has been exceptionally informative, and thank you everybody for all the stories and all the good tips you're giving us all. And I will be starting soon. It's getting into the pen and paper, making copies and doing things like that. So it's getting more and more real every day. So thank you everybody, and sorry I didn't remove my hand, and sorry I took somebody's place. Y'all have a great evening.
You didn't take anybody's place, and I'm glad you said that. Thanks for the compliment. And you're doing it the right way. The pen and paper, write it out, draw you a little plan. It doesn't have to be fancy, and start checking off those goals that you have each day.
All right, Roberto Valentin, go ahead.
I didn't know. I must have hit it by mistake. Sorry. I don't know. I was writing a checkout. Sorry about that.
No problem. Hey, while you're on there, are you vending yet, Roberto?
I have been for, 2.5 years, but I only do it on weekends and some events and some catering. I have a full-time job, which is about averaging 50 plus a week hours. So really I only do on the weekends mainly, but I've been having a lot of side jobs from private events and people that keep calling me to do something. Now, coincidentally, they have contacted me yesterday from a high school, and they want me to submit my paperwork for background check and everything to be a vendor for their games and events certain times of the season. So hey, why not try it out?
Those are good gigs. I have some of those. Those are great gigs.
I have my biggest event that I said let me start doing. I was doing the street. Yeah, I'm in the flea market on the weekends, and you know, I'm kind of burnt out from that, from, you know, doing 7 days working, 7 days, 7 days, 7 days. Then when I started doing hospital gig, private event. I just did a fundraiser for back to school, and everything was successful. And I've been doing a couple of private gigs and stuff like that. I said, that's where I'm going to put my effort in, because I'm just worn out working. I don't plan on quitting my job. My job pays very well. I make a good salary, good living with the job, but I just wanted to do something to fall back in case anything happens. And that's what I ended up doing. But right now, I think I'm going to give up the weekend gigs and start focusing more on events and private catering and things like that. Like I was saying before, my first, on the 21st of September, have an 8-hour event, Hispanic Heritage Festival, and that'll be my first true event that I paid for. So we got 4 of us to work. Let's see what happens. And I'm doing a lemonade there as well.
You'll kill it doing lemonade. Hey, Roberto, the other thing is, you're building up a business that if you ever wanted to just get out of it, you've got something to sell there. I mean, it's worth money.
Yeah, I don't see myself. I've been offered money for my business. because of the way I have it set up and stand. It looks really nice. It looks professional. And people, hey, whenever. But you know what? What they say, the first person that talks money loses. And the guy always keeps passing by, you know, every couple of months. But he, hey, make me offer. I can't refuse. Maybe I won't refuse it, but I'm not going to be asking for the money.
Yeah, well, best of luck to you.
All right, thank you.
Let's see here. Ron Hart, you're on.
I was I was listening to the show and I hit the button.
Hey, how did I get on?
How you doing, Ron?
I'm doing well. I got a little success story to share with you.
Go ahead.
When we started this bakery in 2009, we started as a cottage industry in Akron, Ohio. And my wife, Susan, was selling at farm markets. And she'd have to bake for 2 days in a row in the home oven to have enough bread to sell at the farm markets. But at the end of the season, people kept asking us, well, where can we get the bread? Well, we ended up partnering up with another bakery and working out of there. And from there, this thing is sort of mushroomed. Used to have a store out at a gigantic flea market in Ohio. And had some employee problems, so we shut that down. Now we do events every weekend. And we've been moving right along. The first part of this summer has been real rough with the rain and then the heat wave following it. So I'm in this hole, and all I had to get out with is a popsicle stick. Somebody finally threw me a plastic spoon so I can see light at the top now.
That's good.
Yep.
That's great.
And we just keep on plugging away. We got a catering pro cart, and anytime we can get lemonade into an event, we consider that to be the income doubler.
Yeah, lemonade has treated, I believe, most of us pretty good.
Oh, yeah. Sometimes
yeah,
it's a little
for everyone
tough
else to get that's listening. Oh, sorry.
Sometimes it's a little tough to get in events with it, but the events we do get in with it, it's awesome. We also do Italian ice. This weekend I'm doing an event. I'm doing the elote, and I'm doing walking tacos. Because I couldn't get in with hot dogs.
There you go. Way to switch it up just to be able to get your foot in the door. Because at some point, maybe the hot dog guy ends up doing something else, and then you're already there, and you can become the hot dog guy too.
Oh yeah. Well, thanks for letting me talk, and I do appreciate everybody here. And it's always a learning experience every time I'm tuned in.
Well, thank you, Ron. All right. Listen, it's already almost 9:30, so we're going to wrap this up with one more question. And, Ken, this may be something up your alley. This got asked twice, two different people, same, not exactly same wording, but basically, how do you do high volume lemonade, and is it possible by yourself?
High volume, it depends on what they classify as high volume. I usually have at events two of us anymore doing lemonade. Just depends on the day, the traffic flow. But yes, it is possible. I mean, you just gotta be prepared for it. If you've done the event before, keep records so you know what to do next year. Like last weekend, it was a 2 day event. The big day was Saturday when my brother and I both were slinging lemonade for the majority of the day. And 2 hours before the event was technically over, I ran out of lemons. So, you know, and I increased the number of lemons from the previous year. But it's all about how you have your setup. You know, you want to make sure your system is real simple to flow through. If you've never done lemonade before, keep it simple. You know, I wouldn't recommend getting all the fruit flavors. Just do strictly lemonade. I have a sugar-free option, which most vendors do not offer. But just keep it simple. But yes, it is possible. And they can contact me, Ben, if they have any questions, you know.
Well, thank you a bunch for that. I would be hesitant to take on a lemonade deal by myself. I went and worked a Porsche show event with Alex a year or so ago in Hot Springs, North Carolina. And it was me and his wife, and it was busy. We were banging it out, and it was busy as two people want to be. Yeah. And Alex had already slowed down the crowd or the line because he was serving hot dogs at the front of it. So it was still a challenge. So I would get help if I was going to go do it. Because otherwise you
I wouldn't do it alone.
Yeah.
Volkswagen over here in Maggie Valley, and it was like BMW, but a third of the size. And we did the hot dogs, sausages, the venison, and the lemonades. And I had three people there this time, finally. And it gave me a little time to breathe. We could have done it with two, but at one person, it's just too much. Sometimes you just need somebody to talk to also.
Yeah. But it helps. It helps anytime because you never know, things can happen. And so when I was with Alex, he didn't even kind of expect the volume. He had brought enough stock of everything, but the ice, some of the ice melted partway and chunked up. So it slowed us down a bit. And so we had to go get more ice because it was just crowded. I mean, we were slammed. So those things happen. And I've seen Ken gets busy. You'll find that you'll want help for it, but it's great.
You need coolers, lots and lots of coolers.
Yep.
And big ones. I took 18 10-pound bags. I know I can fit what in what coolers now, and I keep them in the bags just to keep everything sanitary. I've seen guys now dumping in coolers, but you really have to clean a cooler. You're never going to understand how much cooler upkeep and how many coolers you have to have. And you can't let water sit in them. You got to keep them clean, let the sun dry them out good, keep them open. I mean, you need a storage room for just coolers when you start thinking about big volume and lemonade and water. Water weighs a ton, and you need a ton of water and you need a ton of ice. And it all weighs a lot and it takes up a lot of space. We did a case of limes, 140 limes, and a half case of lemons. It's just a slow side gig. That's probably $600, but that will fill your entire vehicle once you start really thinking about what it takes to do it.
Well,
yeah, for one case.
Go ahead, Ken.
I was going to say, for one case, for example, just to touch what Alex is saying, for 140 count lemons, I have one cooler that holds, I have more than one cooler, but I take one cooler with me, holds 120 pounds of ice. And then I'll have about 35 to 40 gallons of water. A gallon of water, from what I understand, weighs 8 pounds.
It does.
So you got to be thinking of all this, of being able to haul it and transport it. It'll wear you out. I mean, if you're doing it by yourself, it will wear you out for sure.
And if you're in Vendors United, we've got prep lists and everything. Michael Wood creates some awesome, it's that military training list, so that you check it off and you know that you got everything when you get there. Corey was talking about John Kavanaugh, who used to be a vendor, and he since passed away, but he did that first big event and he forgot big things. You know, he forgot like hot dogs. They were in the car, but he forgot them. And so there's things like that. I want to do this. I know we got to go. I want to thank Michael, Mark, Alex, Keith, Ken, Diz, Corey. I love you all. And I thank you for taking the time out of a Wednesday night to come on here and share and help others. I thank you from the bottom of my heart. It's freaking awesome.
It's all about helping everybody out there. No joke. We were in that same spot.
Yep, absolutely. We want to help people succeed.
Do y'all have, I'd like to go through, y'all just do it one at a time. If you want to say something, you can. If you don't, you don't. Final words, motivation, something to give to everybody that's been here listening for an hour and a half.
Yeah, keep it simple. Listen, you know, reach out to the pros that's on this webinar and avoid that little, like Mark was talking about. You get a voice in your head that says it can't be done. Ignore it. Talk just the opposite to yourself, because a lot of this is in your head, especially when you're first starting out. Ignore those voices. We all get them. I still get them, and I've been doing this for a long time. You just got to reverse your thinking. You know, you got to think about winning and success and push your way through it. If you got a wall, jump over it, dig under it, go around it. And if you have any challenges, just reach out to us, and we'll help.
Awesome. Thank you, Ken.
Yeah, and then to go on Ken's point there, you know, be open-minded as you go through this. Listen to the people you have here, other vendors that are in VU and other available sources you have. The biggest thing is you see some people that are very closed-minded. They want to do it their way. We'll give suggestions, and, you know, they don't take it. So just be open-minded. Give things a try. I'm where I'm at for no other reason than the group that's here. And then the many other 300 plus some odd people that are in the Vendors United group, listening to them and taking advice. And that's what it's really about. Being open-minded, taking advice, try some things, take multiple advices. You know, Mark may have one way of doing it. Corey has another way. Ken has another way. And then mold your own out of that, right? But, right. You know, listen and be open-minded. But you'll be successful going forward.
Thank you, Diz.
Hey, I would say invest in yourself. I see somebody had made a comment, well, it costs money for permits and it costs money for this and money for that. Yeah, nothing's free. And so I've always invested in myself. I've always gambled on myself instead of paying, you know, for somebody else. I'll pay for advice. $27 a month was the best $27 I spent. But yeah, I'll always bet on myself. And it does take money to start this thing, but not a whole lot. And you can get this thing rolling, and it'll snowball. It will absolutely snowball.
Fantastic. Thanks, Keith.
I would probably say start small and work your way up. Don't try to be everything for everybody. You can't do everything. It's impossible, in my opinion. If you're good at doing lemonades, do lemonades. If you're good at doing hot dogs, do hot dogs. And then work other things into that as you let the business pay for itself instead of you spending money. The money's there, but you've got to work. And it is work. And always remember, good, good.
I appreciate it, Michael.
Hey, I'm just going to say, you know what? We all watch each other. I watch all these guys and so many others, and even probably a lot of you that are there, you know, I'm always be open to learn new things and take advice from people on stuff. There's some things, you know, that roll off like water on a duck's back. Other things, you know, you put that away, you write it down on your pad, and you go, you know what, I might need to do that. But the big of it is, you know, success is all relative. My success and how I view my success is going to be different from how Mark or Keith or Ken or any of these guys view it. You know, it might be you have an extra day. You get to spend time with your kids more. Maybe that's success for you. Don't try and be bigger than you are, than what you really want to be. Because honestly, the more you do, you start giving up some of that freedoms again. So, you know, just find your sweet spot and stick with that.
Thank you, Corey. Anybody else? All right, guys. I thank you for being here. I know we couldn't cover everybody's questions. I have put some links in the chat that you can go find lots of answers. I know it isn't near as fun as having them answered live. I will try to do more of these, or at least be on YouTube more to help you out as much as possible. Please take the money you were going to spend at Pizza Hut next week and join VU for the sake of your business. We have a vendor that has Squatch Dogs out west, and you can follow him. He's a young guy, Tyler, and He is phenomenal. And he was in VU for a year before he even started. So when he started, he had years of experience, because just in this panel right here, you've got over 100 years of experience sitting there, of real, maybe not 100, I made that up, but it's close, right? Well, Michael, if you count his age and, you know, subtract, anyway, you've got a lot of value here, and it'd be an opportunity of a lifetime. I know I said I wasn't going to pitch anything. They kind of, goaded me because they kept bringing up VU, but, I look forward to seeing your success story. Share it with me. You ain't got to buy crap from me, and I'll still help you. We all will. I love you, and I wish you the most success that you can possibly stand to fill all your pockets up. Talk to you later.
Love you, Ben. Love you, guys.
Love you, Ken.
Peace out.
Good.